about, or we have read the story of the burning bush. And I want to take that passage, that story of the burning bush, and give some revelation that God has put on my heart, which we normally, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, we normally don't dwell on those, you know, passages as much as we need to. You know, when I looked at the story of the burning bush, we all talk about how that was a powerful story where one man by the name Moses, who had a destiny that God had called him to, but he was kind of receding from that particular destiny. And this was a moment that God brings him back to his original call. And that is what happened at that burning bush, or the experience of the burning bush. But to me, it ended there. But then today morning in my exploration, I came to realize that it does not stop there. The phrase burning bush has been used repeatedly in the Bible even after that. In fact, Jesus used it almost twice. When Jesus spoke about it, he said, you know, do you know the burning bush passage? That means the Jewish people were very much acquainted with the burning bush story. So that Jesus could make reference to that particular story in his teaching on resurrection. And Stephen, before he was stoned to death, he spoke about the burning bush. I would be making mention of it, you know, at least glance through some of those as time would permit. But today, let me go to the story in itself and then proceed from there. What is the story of the burning bush? It was the groundbreaking story, if I could call it. It was a watershed moment, not just in the life of Moses, but also in the history of Israel. There wouldn't be a Sinai. There wouldn't be a promised land. There wouldn't be people crossing the Red Sea if it wasn't for the experience at the burning bush. Do you agree with me? That became the experience that produced other experiences. It became like the progenitor of all the other experiences that came after that. In fact, that was a moment that broke through the silence of heaven and produced a release of the supernatural. From that moment onwards, nothing remained the same. Slavery came to an end. People were remarkably and extraordinarily, miraculously delivered from Israel, from Egypt, because of that experience. A man changed completely. Here is a man whose life became too ordinary, even though he was called for something extraordinary. Imagine he grew up in the most advanced place called Egypt, trained in the skills of Egypt. But after a while, after that encounter where things didn't go well, one incident, everything goes down into a backward kind of a situation for him. You know, he becomes a man who's now feeding his father-in-law's flock. Can you imagine? Everything for him is ordinary. It's an ordinary day. It's the ordinary sheep. It's the ordinary routine. Ordinary mountain. Ordinary bushes that he has seen for 40 years. Nothing out of the ordinary. But that one morning, when everything seemed routine, he saw something that was extraordinary. And that caught his attention. I want to make this as a statement. If God has called you for something special, remember, God can bring extraordinary out of the ordinary. The day that you might wonder and think and say, you know what? This is just like any other day. Could be the day that decides your destiny forever. Can I get it? You know, we all are looking forward for such a day. Because many of us are carrying visions and dreams and destinies that are beyond the normal and the ordinary. But let me tell you, our lives have become settled into routine. The same thing every day. But I feel in my heart, if God gave me a message with regards to the burning bush and what it implies, I strongly believe God wants to intervene and interject into our human routine and produce something that can change our life forever. That was a day. But what was so interesting, when we look at the word bush, I went and looked at the word shittim or acacia wood. You know, the word means not just a dry bush. It means a thorny bush. In fact, it simply means a bush that is made of thorns, long, sharp spikes. And I've seen that in the Middle Eastern countries. Very, very, you know, sharp thorns And let me, when I look at it, what it signifies. I know people can have a lot of mystical ideas. I don't want to go into that. But let me say in simple terms, what does thorn represent in the Bible? It simply represents the truth that it's a curse. Throughout the Bible, thorns don't stand for blessing. It represents curse. Right from the time Adam and Eve sinned, the Bible says earth produced thorns and thistles. Throughout the Bible, thorns has only one meaning, curse and sin. But here is God's fire. And fire stands for only one thing in the Bible. It stands for judgment. And what? How can a thorny, dry bush be any match to the judgment fire of God? But here is where the story applies to us. We were all people filled with sin, and curse and thorns were indications of our lives. But one day the fire came. But thankfully, the fire did not destroy us. The fire did not consume us. The fire protected our lives because of the grace of God. Can I get a shout of hallelujah in the house of the Lord? Is anybody who can say, my life was a thorny bush, and when the fire of God came upon me, it did not destroy me, but protected me? If you believe that, can I hear a sound of amen in the house? I could have been destroyed by this fire. The Bible says the fire did not consume it. And because the Lord was in the fire, the word is Shekinah, from where we get the word Shekinah. The glory of God was inside the fire, and that's the reason the fire could not burn. You know, the Jewish rabbis have gone beyond that, and they said the fruit of the tree was still there. The green did not turn color. Everything remained the same because it was a glorious fire, not consuming. And let me make a statement here. Some of you can identify with it today. Many a times when you went through fire, the enemy said it's over. Your family is over. Your children are over. The green is over. The fruit is over. But today, how many of you can say, I'm still alive. I'm here praising God because God protected my life. If that's your story, you know, one of the words, how many of you know when you're coming to the end of your life, that's not something that I really want to seriously consider today. But when you come to the end of your life, there'll be one experience that'll stand out of all the experience by which you want to identify yourself. When Jacob was blessing the children of Joseph, do you know what? He kept on saying, the Lord Almighty, the Lord Almighty, the Lord Almighty, the Lord who watched over me, the Lord who protected me. You know what? That was the experience of this man throughout his life. And that's what he can pass it on as a legacy to his grandchildren. Moses, when he's about to die, you know what he said? He did not say the God who came to me in Sinai. He did not say the God who divided the Red Sea and brought manna from heaven. You know what he said about God? The God who dwells in the burning bush. And when I come to the close of my life, there will be something that I will say. The God who anointed me at the age of 12. Sometimes I can't think about any other thing, but one day at the age of 12, the anointing of the Lord came upon me and I started to preach in India. And let me tell you, anybody who can say, I have got something about my God, I can tell my children and grandchildren, this God is a faithful God. Can I get somebody to say something about your God? What a God we serve! Hey, this God is so good. That is the story of Moses. But what is so fascinating? He says God dwelt, he was dwelling in the burning bush. It's not a statement that says he just went, came and visited and went away. He dwelt there. Shekinah. But then I thought, how did that happen? When did that happen? Because the encounter of Moses with the burning bush was very brief. And the Lord opened my eyes today. Do you know when God gave command to build the tabernacle? Everything that was so special, the outer courtyard and the ark, which represents the presence of God, that's where God came down on the mercy seat. It was made of acacia wood. Can you imagine the process of how it would have happened? These woods, God says this wood should stand upright. Let me tell you, no acacia wood will stand upright. And that's my nature. That's our nature. It's a twisted tree. You can go to Middle East and find out. You can even Google. No acacia would stand upright. We were all twisted. Sorry for the language. But God took this twisted wood and made us upright in Christ. Can I see some twisted once upon a time, but now upright by the grace of God? Come on, walking straight. Come on, thinking straight. Can I hear somebody who knows what I'm saying? Once upon a time, my thinking was distorted. My actions were distorted. But right now, I'm righteous in Christ Jesus. I have got one desire. I want to bring glory to the name of my Heavenly Father. He turned you up to a very upright man, a woman. And then what did he do? He cleaned up the thorns. And then put gold. You know, when the enemy looks at us today, all thorny bushes, who was always a thorn on everybody's side, is now looking so good. Let me take the gold outside from Anison. It's all made of thorns inside. But he polished it. He put gold upon us. Gold stands for divine nature. He took that sinful nature from us, the curse from us, and he covered us with the gold of God's divine nature. Can I hear the sound of people who can say, once upon a time, I was cursed and I was cursed by God, but today I'm walking in the nature of my Heavenly Father. I've become partaker of the divine nature. If you have a testimony, can you showcase your praise? Hey! That is a story. And God decided to dwell. Can you imagine God is sitting on that ark? Once upon a time, if he had sat on that ark, I tell you, it was thorny. But now God can sit comfortably on this ark. It's gold. And that's what he made us to be. Once upon a time, we were so separated from God. God could not come close to us. We could not get close to God. But today, he's dwelling. You didn't hear that. I said he's dwelling among people who were once upon a time carriers of the thorns, but right now bought and planted by the grace of God, removed from our sinful nature, planted with the nature of God himself. What a testimony! What a turn of events! Can I hear the voice of people who want to say, God, you can dwell among us right now because of your grace and because of what you have done for us. Can I hear a shout of hallelujah in the house of the Lord? This is what God made us to be. And I'm going to make a statement of faith in your families. In the city of Edmonton, there are many shitting woods full of thorns carrying the curse of God upon their lives. But in the days to come, the anointed men of God will go from this place, hew that tree, cut down those trees, and will bring them into the house of the Lord. They will be clothed with the glorious presence of a living God, and the lives will be changed. Can I hear the agreement of people who believe sinners are going to be saved in Edmonton? Drug addicts are going to come to Jesus. I could stay here for long, but that's not my intention today. Let me go to prophetic word that he gave me. Three promises that he gave me today. One, he said to me, the burning bush, it represents, you know, curse. But this is where God, how many of you know when Jesus took that crown on his head, they believe it was the same thorn. That day, he was giving you a channel through which your curse can be turned into a blessing. Jesus took the curse. No more thorns. You have become a blessing. But I want to bring three promises. I don't know why God gave me that. And I want to give it to you today. This is a prophetic word. Receive it with that kind of a sense. God is speaking to me. Number one, Jesus made a statement. Look at the statement that Jesus made in Mark 12 and 26. Mark 12:26. But concerning the dead, that they rise, have we not read in the book of Moses, in the burning bush passage? Every Jew knew this passage. It is significant to them. How God spoke to him and said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Next verse. He is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. Do you know? It was that burning bush where we got the greatest revelation of God. I am that I am. But he says, it is not, I was the God of Abraham. I am the God of Abraham. That means Abraham is still alive. Isaac is still alive. Jacob is still alive. I asked the Lord God, what does that mean? And the Lord told me something. You know, as long as there's a covenant of God upon your life, there's a promise of God upon your life, to God, it is all still alive. Every promise of God, you might think it is over. And I kept on hearing the word, people using the word, I was. And the Lord told me, don't use that anymore. God says, today I am. I am your God. I am your fulfiller of your promise. I am the faithful God. It is not I was, I am today. So anybody in this place who have gone to a place of once upon a time I was, and I don't even know what I am today, God says, I am not the God of I was, I am the God of I am. He's not the God of you were. He's a God of who you are today. That means everything about God in your life, everything, the promise that God has spoken, he's speaking from the burning bush. It is still alive in him and well. If you really believe God's plan for my life is still alive, can I get a shout of hallelujah in the house of the Lord? It was not you were. It is God wants to do it over here today. You are. He's not the God of the dead. Every promise in him is still alive. Every covenant in him is still alive. Let me tell you, Abraham to us might be dead, but if the promise of God to Abraham's children is still alive. To the promise of God to Jacob is still alive. So can I hear from the bottom of your heart, anybody willing to say, everything about God in my life, everything that God has promised in my life is still alive? Come on, you can do better. I'm just giving you a chance to respond to God's word. You can do it better. Everything that God has promised, it doesn't matter. The world might say you're dead. The people might say you're dry bones. But God says, I'm not the God of the dead. I'm the God of the live, living. And you are alive to me. Oh, the Lord is prophesying over somebody. The devil is looking at some families and say, your children are dead. You are dead. But God says, you are not dead. If I am your God, you are alive. Your children are alive. Your promises are alive. Come on, somebody receive it. God says, I am your God and the God of the living. Hallelujah. You want to see God of the dead? Come to India. Everything is, it's glorified when it comes to death. Everything is death. You know, some of the gods are gods depicting death. But let me tell you, I don't serve a God who is a God who's dead and serving dead people. There's no coffin connected to Christianity. Let me make this very clear. There is nothing that is symbolic of death. And we have only one symbol. That's an open tomb, open grave. Everything about Christianity is alive. And let me tell you today, it's a God who's living, ministering to living people by his living word. Come on, somebody who knows what I'm saying. This is not a dead word. God is speaking to dead people. It is a living word that God is speaking to living people today, because he's a God of the living. Or can I get somebody to believe it? I'm going to make a statement. The time has come for the churches to understand it is not songs and preaching and prayer of dead people that's going to illuminate us, going to encourage us. Let me tell you, even if you were to sing a song from 200 years back, it'll be full of life. Come on. Sometimes when we walk into a church, you will feel as if you are attending a wrong service. Maybe a funeral is taking place. Let me tell you, wherever Jesus came, even when a funeral is taking place, life came back. Life came back. And I want to declare today, He is not the God of the dead. He is a God of the living. His word is real. His word is alive. His spirit is alive. His power is alive. His promises are alive. And can I hear somebody who say, Edmonton is going to see the dead coming back to life, because we have a living God. We have a God who is a God of a living. Oh, come on. Hallelujah. So I'm going to make one statement before I pull out of this place, out of this point. I want to make this statement. We don't have a memorial service of God who was. I feel pity for the cessationists who believe that miracles have stopped. You know, things have stopped. Somehow God decided 20th century is too frightening for Him. Let me just pull out of this miracle business. I tell you, I feel bad for them. Because this God is not the God of who was. Yes, He used Peter. He is James. But He's not God who was. He is God who is. That means He's a God of Edmonton today. He's a God of Anison today. He's a God of the city today. If you believe He's a God of the living, so I'm going to make a prophetic word over here in the name of Jesus. Edmonton churches are not going to see a memorial service of God who was, but we are going to see our service of God who is the same. Oh, I don't know how you can sit quietly, because this is a word from the throne room of heaven. We are going to see a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. This is a message from the burning bush. If you're looking for a church where dead sermons are preached to dead people, this is not that place. Here is a place where living preachers are preaching living word to living people, because our God is living. He's not the God of the dead. He's a God of the living. Now, can I hear? Can you give this living God not a dead, dying praise? Some of your praise feels like it just became too anemic. Anemic, come on. Some of the praise looks so crippled and as if it came out of a hospital. Doesn't have any life in it. Can you give a living God a living praise in the house? Because He's a God of a living. He's a God of a living. He's a God of a living. Hey. Hallelujah. Let me go ahead to my second point. You know, this is a place where, please don't get me wrong if I'm not able to make proper sense of what I'm saying, because I don't even know how to put it across, honestly. Because, can I say the secret behind this? When I got this word, this is one of the verses, one of the passages that I think I waited before God probably 4 or 5 hours this morning. Because it doesn't, it's not connecting. But I thought of changing my message. I thought, okay, God, You can connect this next week. Let me go to another one. He didn't allow me. So I remember I went and fell on the bed. And I stayed there. I said, God, You're not allowing me to change the message. And You're not giving me the connection. And the connection, the word that I heard, I don't, you know me, I'm not a person who harbs on prosperity and all that. I know God will prosper His people. And we need money for our building. I know God will bless us for the sake of His kingdom. When we get blessed, we will bless the kingdom more. But I heard this word, when the message came to me, it came as two words: burning bush and prosperity. I said, what's the connection? Burning bush and prosper, doesn't make any connection. And then He gave me this connection. If you want to receive it, just receive it. So this is fresh from God. It came out of a man who waited, struggled, and fell on his face to get a word from God. This is what he told me. Deuteronomy 33 and verse number 13 onwards. I want you to listen. Even if you don't make noise, it's okay. It's okay. But if you really get it, and if you want to make a noise, nobody's going to stop you. But I want you to get this into your spirit. So listen. And of Joseph, he said, now look at those words. If you look at the blessing that God gives Joseph, I think it is far beyond the blessing any other tribe received. For what a reason, you know, Joseph became the person, the source, the representation of blessing. And of Joseph, he said, blessed of the Lord is his land. Look how everything is coming together to bless him. That's the two things I want you to look at. One, the connection of everything is coming together to bless him. All things work together. When God decides to bless you, even the negative things is working towards. Now, this might look really naive for me to say this, but some of you need to believe sometimes God says things which doesn't make sense. Sometimes even recession will work together. So let me say, blessed of the Lord is his land with the precious things of heaven, with the dew and the deep lying beneath. Look at heaven and earth is getting connected to bless this man. The deep of the earth and the heaven is coming together. Next verse. With the precious fruit of the sun. Can we put that from King James Version? It's interesting. With the precious fruit of the sun. With the precious fruit of the sun, by the sun, and for the precious things put forth by the moon. The sun is putting forth. And the moon is also joining. To bless this one man. Wow. You know, recently somebody said the sun is going to bring a lot of problem because it's blazing and global warming. I want to say today, when God decides to bless you, the sun will contribute. And the moon says, I don't want to be left behind. Am I talking to people who want to be blessed by God? Some of you think, you know, it's okay, I somehow I'll manage, you know. But if you really want God's blessing, can you sit with a smile on your face? Come on. Okay, there we go. Next to us. And for the chief things of the ancient mountains and for the precious things of lasting things. You know, did you look at that? Ancient mountains comes from the past. Ancient. Everlasting hills. That's going to the future. Heaven, earth, moon, sun. The past, the present. And you know what it says? The chief things, it's agriculture. I looked at some of the Hebrew words. And precious things are metals. That you'll get the crop and the metals. Precious metals coming from mountains. I don't know why the Lord is giving these mountain messages a lot. Next verse. And for the precious things of the earth and the fullness thereof and the goodwill of him. That's a word used as favor. Of everything you have got God's favor. That dwelt bush. So now I know the connection. The God who came down into the bush wants to bless you. Now I know why he gave me those two words. From the bush, blessings. And today it's coming to somebody. From the bush, blessing. The Lord who dwelt in the bush, who took your life, which was a cursed life. He wants to show to the world, I can take a thorn. He wants to show to the world, I can take a thorn and make it a blessing. Can I get a shout of hallelujah? Brothers and sisters, there's no way we are supposed to reach that place God has called us to. We don't belong to that club by nature. But God is saying, I want to show in Canada to the people in your family, I can take somebody That was a thorn. And when my presence is inside, everything will work together. Even the bad things will work together. And she will become, he will become a representation of my grace, of my power, of my blessing. Is anybody who wants to say, God, I receive it on my life. Come on. You know what? When I preach in Africa, I preach to big groups. You know, sometimes I preach to tens of thousands of people. And some of those people, you know what they do? When I'm preaching, they'll say, and some of our people are sitting there, that's a good point. Can you do some action? God is taking some thorny bush and making it a representation of the highest, most glorious blessing that he can do in somebody's life. If you won't receive it, can you show it with some action? Let the blessing come upon the head of Joseph and the top of the head of him that was separated from his brethren. But that doesn't stop there. Next verse. His glory is like the firstling of his bullock. And his horns like the horns of unicorns. You know what it means? It means he's got such power. He's full of strength. He's not a victim. He's a conqueror. He shall push the people together to the ends of the earth. Let me tell you, no people group of the earth can stop him. He will push them. He's marching forward. And then it says, I like this word, these are the 10,000s of Ephraim and the thousands of Manasseh. You know what it means? Thousands and 10,000, anytime in the Bible, it means innumerable. It cannot be counted. It's going to multiply, increase. This anointing of increase, anointing to conquer, anointing where everything around you will work together for your good. You know what the Lord told me? Can I say this? He told me something very special. He told me, do you know the first time when heaven opened and the earth opened, the whole earth was destroyed by a flood. It was a deluge. Nobody could withstand it. Everything was taken out. It was a huge flood, like a tsunami multiplied 10,000 times. When heaven opened and the earth opened as well. But the Lord told me, when I turn curse, next time, when heaven opens and earth also opens, you will not be destroyed. You're not just getting a small drip of blessing. You're going to flow in the... So I'm going to make a prophetic statement. The last time heaven opened and the earth opened, there was a destruction of the whole earth. The whole earth was carried out of the way. But this time the Lord said, heaven is going to open and the earth will open and I will release such a blessing. Hallelujah. Can you imagine, instead of the flood of destruction, you are now in the flood of blessing. But he also said to me a word. Do you know Psalmist says, the book of Psalms says, the sun will not smite you and the moon will not destroy you. Sun and moon coming together is always connected to destruction. But in Joseph's case, the sun will bless you. The moon will bless you. Everything that worked as a curse for somebody else is going to become the channel of your blessing. Because this is God speaking from the bush. He says, I'm going to turn your curse around. Everything that was a curse for other families, it'll be a blessing for you. Even the pain that you went through. I want somebody in this place who believes that when God is going to bless you, everything will work together. The good and the bad. Things that might make you afraid is going to work together for your good. Is anybody... Can I get at least two people who want to be carried on the flood of blessing? Come on. Can I get not a limited blessing, but an overflow of blessing? Come on. If you believe that, shout a hallelujah in the house. I'm not talking about a shower of blessing. I'm talking about a deluge of blessing. I'm talking about a flow of blessing, an overflow of blessing.
It'll go to your generation, your children, and your children's children. It will bless. This is God speaking from the bush.
I'm going to make a prayer. Lord, I release that over Zion Church. But the recession, the sun, the moon, and everything, even things that once upon a time was making us crazy and go bad and go destroyed, is going to come together to work on our behalf. This is God speaking. He's anybody who wants to make a statement against the powers of evil. Every situation in my life, he's going to turn around to become good. If you believe that, can you make a statement which... Let the enemy hear that. Let the enemy hear that. Even the things that are bad in my life, it's going to become beautiful in the name of Jesus. If you believe that, shout hallelujah to the Lamb. Udabalaba shabaladala halmana sakanya handala rabashia. I want to tell the Lord, and his sin standing before you does not deserve this blessing. My life was a life full of thorns. But today he's speaking from the thorny bush. He's going to turn things around. Anybody can say, Lord, I don't deserve it, but I receive it today by your grace. Only such people with a joy in your heart, just give a sign of reception with a praise in your mouth. Come on, you're receiving this unlimited blessing of God. The same flood that took over the nations is going to become a flood of blessing over your life in the name of Jesus. God says it's not a small drip, it's a flood, it's a flood, it's a flood of blessing. Now some of you are going to understand why God gave us a message a few weeks back. You know what the Lord told me? With this I'm done. I'm finishing. Do you know Israel camped in over 40, 50 places before they reached the promised land? But do you know the place that they camped the last? Just before the promised land? The last place. That means some of you are too close. Numbers 33:49. And they pitched by Jordan from Beth Jeshimoth even unto Abel Shittim in the plains of Moab. You know what it means? It means Abel Shittim. Abel means, it's not the Abel from the story of Abel and Cain. It means meadows. It's a good word, meadows. But do you know what the meaning of the word Shittim? Thorns. The last place that they pitched was a place called the Plain of Thorns. Why would God, who started this journey in a burning bush, thorn bush, is bringing them to the thorn, the meadows of thorn, before taking them inside? I'll give you one more verse, Joshua 2 and verse number 1. Joshua the son of Nun sent out from Shittim, meaning thorns, 2 men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. Just before they could go into Jericho, they pitched their tent in a land full of thorns. And some of you in this place are encountering that sense of thorns all around. Such discomfort. You go into a house, it's an experience of thorn. Your health, your children. But God says, get ready. From this place, you know what's the meaning of the word Jericho? The plain of palm trees. From the plain of thorns, you're entering the meadows of palm trees. Palm tree stands for shelter.
comfort. I came from the presence of God with a message. Some families who were encountering thorns are just about to enter the promised land. Can I hear? Some of you thought, God, I'm feeling that pricking, that sense of discomfort. Something is suffocating me. But tonight, get ready. You're coming out into the promised land. The last place you pitch your tent is a place of thorns. But do you know that your life began inside a thorn when God appeared? If you can say, this is where God met me, He's going to transform my thorn atmosphere into a promised land. Amen. Only such people give the Lord a praise as an agreement of faith. Come on, give the Lord a praise. This is where your life started. This is where you are today. It's the grace of God. It's the presence of God. You can tell the devil, I'm alive today. Even though I was supposed to die, even though I was supposed to be consumed, I'm alive today because of God's grace upon my life. And can you tell the Lord, this is the last place I'm pitching my tent. My next place is a promised land. It's a place of glory. It's a place of the palm trees. Can you give a Lord a praise in the house of the Lord? Come on. Somebody who knows in their heart, this is the last place where I'm going to pitch my tent. Come on. This thorn experience is going to come to an end in the name of Jesus. This is a prophetic word. I can sense a mighty electricity falling on my body when I'm saying this. I don't say this because to impress you. I'm not saying this. It is real. Something is happening all over my body. The Lord is telling me to tell you, get ready. Some of my people, this is the last place. This thorn experience is the last place where you're going to pitch your tent. And from here, you are entering the palm. Come on, anybody who knows what I'm saying. The Spirit of God is testifying in your spirit. Can you make some responses in the house of the Lord? From here, you're entering the place of your promise. The place of your palm trees. From Shittim to Jericho. Can I get one person to make a descriptive action over here? You have been pitched in the place of thorns. Every day something will bother you. You feel that sense of, you get excited in the house of the Lord when you go back home. It is still that pain. Words are spoken. Issues are happening. But today, can you make an action from this place called the meadows of thorns? You are entering the plain of palm trees. Somebody make this an action for the church as well. Somebody make an action over here. The place of thorns is about to go behind you, and you are about to enter the plain of palm trees. If you believe that, shout a hallelujah in the heart. March with that sense of faith inside of your heart. Move. You know, I'm not in a dramatic mood today. I'm not here to excite you, but this is my life. And I'm pouring it before God in the name of Jesus for some time. Lord, if I've experienced that pitched sense of being around thorns, today I'm leaving it behind me. And I'm entering the place of the palm trees, the place of my promise. If you believe that, can you make a description of agreement in the house of the Lord? You are. We'll pray. Read Acts 7:30. I heard the word redemption. Acts 7:30. From the burning bush, there's going to be redemption. 7:30. And when 40 years were expired, there's an expiry date. The burning bush is a sign of an expiry date. there is an expiry date. And that's the reason this encounter of the burning bush is happening. Burning bush appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. The word in the Greek says, in a thorny bush. He appeared. Next word. And then Moses said, he wondered at the sight. And as he drew near to behold, the voice of the Lord came unto him. Next verse. Verse number 35. This Moses, whom they refused. And the Lord told me, the same place where you were rejected. They did not accept your promise. They did not accept the hope that you had. They could not understand what in the world you're talking about. They thought you're pretending. They thought you're trying to become a big shot. But the same place where they did not accept your call, anointing, promise. God said, I'm sending you back. But this time as a ruler and as a deliverer. And by the hand of the angel which appeared to him in the bush. You know what the Lord says? This bush experience is not a one-time experience. The same angel that appeared in the bush is coming with you. Anybody in this place, I'm going to give you a chance. Anybody in this place, you have got such promises of God over your life, but it seems nobody understands it. Nobody gets it. But the Lord says, can you believe this God appeared to you in the bush, changed your life, is going to come with you. There's a redemption happening over here. That means what you lost, what people did not allow you to have, you're receiving it back. A multifold manner in the name of Jesus. If you really believe God is giving a redemption work in your life, put your hands together, give the Lord a praise in the house of the Lord. Everything that you lost, everything that is refused to you, it's coming back in the name of come on, give a Lord of praise. Give a Lord of praise. This time they will receive you. This time they will accept you. This time that you will be their ruler. This time you will be their deliverer. But this time you're going with the angel of God who appeared to you in the bush. You're not going alone. The Lord is coming with you. Every eye is closed. That burning bush became the experience that changed Moses. And today, how many of you want to say, he appeared in the burning bush? That's my life. If you really believe that, the next 30 seconds or so, I'm not going to instigate praise here, but I'm going to give you the chance. If you really believe, this God is going to bless you. This God is going to send you back to the same place where nobody accepted, acknowledged your vision. They could not get it. Even your own family members. And this God is going to do something mighty where this thorn pitched tent is about to be removed. He's taking you to the plains of palm trees, your promised land. If you really believe the God who appeared in the bush is taking you forward, is blessing you, can you give him your personal praise? Give him your praise. Give him your praise. Come on, speak to him. Speak to him. So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I declare today, people who are pitched in the place of thorns are just about to find that this is the last place before they enter the promised land. I declare that over the people of God and over this church. Lord, I believe this promise with all of my heart and would receive it on behalf of your people. And we have been walking it in Jesus' name.